Amy Cuddy, and I'll start like this because this is what people know me for. And there are about a million pictures of me in airports with strangers standing like this. And I'm thrilled that message got out there. So I teach at Harvard Business School, and I never thought that I'd be talking about Wonder Woman. But what I want to tell you is sort of an example of a story that I hear. So I've heard from at least 15,000 people have written to me to tell me their stories, equal numbers, women and men. This is not just, it's not only women who feel like imposters, men do too, everyone does at some point. Actually, if somebody says they never felt like an imposter, I have a hotline number for them to call because there's something else wrong with them. But you know, I was at a coffee shop, this was just a couple of months ago, and a woman came up to me, she was actually serving my coffee, and she said, "I just want you to know that your talk changed my life." And I looked up at her and she said, I am Iranian, I grew up in Texas, I never felt like I fit in. I left, I came to Boston, now I'm working as a waitress, and then I saw your talk and I thought, I want to go to medical school. I've always wanted to go to medical school. Like, what's stopping me from doing that? And she said, so I went to take the MCAT exam, and I stood in the bathroom for 2 minutes like Wonder Woman, and she said, and I totally nailed it. And she said, so now I'm going to medical school. And it captured, I loved that story, and this is why. What I said in the talk was fake it until you become it. I never meant fake your competence. You can't do that. What I meant was unlock what you have, right? It's not that standing like Wonder Woman gave her some knowledge of stem cells or whatever she needed to do well in the MCAT. That was all in there, right? All she needed was this little key that was in her. Right, and this idea of power, this fear that we have about power, I think is so sad. My favorite quote about power is Robert Caro, who studied LBJ for, 30 years. And when somebody said to him, does power corrupt? He said, power doesn't necessarily corrupt, but what I know now is power always reveals. Allow it to reveal who you are. Unlock what's in there. That's all you need to do. Just take the key and unlock it. And I'll end with this thought from Maya Angelou, who said everything that we need to know. She said, stand up straight and realize who you are, that you tower over your circumstances. And I'll leave you with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, I need our lawyer. Elise, please.
Hi, I'm Elise Nelson. I'm president and CEO of a nonprofit called Vital Voices. I think all of us in this room know and have experienced the power of a single day, a single moment to shape the future. Well, 20 years ago today, I was a 21-year-old college student, and I was growing up in an interconnected world, and I was desperate to understand my place as a woman within that world. I heard about something called the United Nations Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing, China. You know that thing that people kind of did and kind of didn't want Hillary Clinton to attend? And I decided I needed to be there. So I saved and I borrowed and I bought the cheapest ticket that I could find, one with, I think, 4 stopovers before I landed in Beijing, China. And there I was surrounded by nearly 50,000 women leaders and advocates from around the world. And I realized as I stood there, these women didn't come to learn their place in the world, they came to fight for it. And I walked away from that experience wanting to fight for it myself, realizing that even though I had a small voice, I had a voice, and I had to use it to empower those who had no voice. I've worked for the past 20 years with women leaders around the world, and I think that I can tell you absolutely that women lead differently. And that difference, I believe, is precisely what our world needs. They've taught me a number of lessons, and I don't have time to tell you all of them today, but I'll tell you 3. They've shown me that real leadership, real leaders, every morning they wake up motivated by making the world and making people's lives better. If you're not that way, you're not a leader. They've also shown me that the only way to accelerate progress is by taking risks and not being afraid to fail. And understanding that failure isn't the opposite of success, it's actually a stepping stone closer to it. And finally, they've shown me that actually the difference between good intentions and great leadership is the courage and commitment to stay the course no matter how difficult the path. I think these are lessons for all of us. I certainly try and live my life by them. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrea.
You always have to know when to ignore the voice of experience. So I'm standing at my 20th high school reunion at Lower Merion High School outside of Philadelphia, surrounded by four other bookish women. And it struck me to ask a question. How in the hell did we all end up as business executives in technology when we had very few role models? And all of a sudden, this one woman said, well, I'm certainly glad that I did not follow the advice of Mrs. Grayboys. At which point, all five of us became completely silent. And she continued by saying, yeah, Mrs. Grayboys, you know, junior year, picking classes, she said, make sure that you don't take AP calculus because you'll stop having menstrual cycles. At which point, all of us stared at her and said, she told you that too? Unbelievable. And what we found out is that the five of us that went on to these careers had all figured out to ignore the voice of experience. And all of us had gone on, probably frightened and in the minority at the time, to go and study that really scary stuff of physics and math, not to go to the prom, to be bookish, and to figure out that there was something inside of us that was bigger than what Mrs. Grayboys told us to do. Now, I am not in judgment of Mrs. Grayboys. I think she made a really great, she had really good intentions, and she really didn't mean to discourage us. She probably had fantastic evidence of a woman before us who had missed all of her periods and wanted to drop out of high school and probably never had children and couldn't get married and everything went terribly. So she was trying to do the best she could. So what I've learned is the second thing about leadership, which is that now, as the CEO of Launchpad Central, which is a technology company in San Francisco, and what we do is we help entrepreneurs within large companies like NASDAQ, the Mayo Clinic, Jones Lang LaSalle, who are also scared. Can you imagine innovators within large companies trying to have their brave voices heard? And so as I work with the teams now of people who are very evidence-based and very rational and very, very passionate about an idea for an entrepreneurial effort within a large company, I think to them, bravely go. Listen to that voice. And that same sense of encouragement is what I believe I learned from Mrs. Grayboys. Now, there's one little coda, which is as follows. We all thought we were the only ones she told that to. Right? So I was thinking, as a woman leader, what are we supposed to do? I think we're supposed to share, and I think we're supposed to support. Because had I known that there were four other women scared to death in that calculus course, I might have reached out and changed the beginning of the next part of my life. Thank you. And
Shiza, thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to start by quoting one of the greats. Martin Luther King once said, human progress isn't inevitable, but requires the struggle, sacrifice of dedicated citizens. That's what I believe underpins leadership. What we do to empower others and to create a more just world. I grew up in Pakistan at a time when violence was rising and civil rights were declining. I was born to parents of humble origin who worked very hard to give me a good education. So I was lucky, but I was aware that most of the women around me weren't as lucky. I learned very early on in life that the world, as it's structured today, is fundamentally unjust. That's where leadership and social justice begins, recognizing injustice. See, in society, too often, injustice is hidden under the guise of, well, it's always been that way. Now, how many of us want to see immigration reform, equal pay for women, gun control? The polls would suggest most of us. But how many of us have gotten actively involved in one of these issues and decided to drive policy change? Any action is leadership. 2 years ago, I co-founded the Malala Fund with the youngest ever Nobel Prize winner, Malala Yousafzai and her father to try and make the world a little bit better. We advocated for girls' education on some of the hardest issues in the world, education for Syrian refugees, protection for girls in northern Nigeria terrorized by Boko Haram, free, universal, secondary schooling for all girls. These are very complex issues, but we believe that our voices and our actions can make a difference. You see, we're taught and we come to believe that we cannot change the world. And even when we're angry, we think, where do we begin? But the truth is, there is nobody else. It's just us. In the words of Margaret Mead, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. Thank you.
Robin. Hi, I'm Robin Chase, founder and former CEO of Zipcar and recently author of a new book called Peers, Inc. When I founded Zipcar, people wanted to tell me that it was impossible, that people didn't like to share, you couldn't trust them, they weren't willing to do this type of thing, they would ruin cars. And I felt like most people I know are good people. And this is the world that I want to live in. I want to live in a world where I can trust that people are good, and I'm going to build this company that follows the vision that I have of people. For the last 10 or more years, I've given a lot of talks. I want to say in the hundreds. And what strikes me is that when people talk about it afterwards or when they write comments, I get these two consistent words. Wow, Robin is so passionate, and Robin is so honest. And every time I hear those, and the more I hear them, and I tell this to my husband and my oldest daughter when I hear it, it's a kind of depressing thing. Why is it that that is a unique characteristic? Why should anyone ever be doing something that they're not passionate about? You know, why are CEOs talking in boring terms about what they're doing, and why would you ever do things that you don't love? So I am passionate. And this idea of honesty as being a kind of unique trait that you have to call out, like, wow, Robin is honest. So as we move forward and women accept more leadership roles, my hope is that we are in our work lives as we are in our family and friendship lives, that we have values and we're honest and we have empathy and we believe those attributes, and that work is not some other different thing that you have a new set of rules, that we are better than a lot of men leaders, and that we set a new bar, and that we are integral in our lives, that we don't become different icky people when we become business people, and that we start becoming lying and dispassionate people. So my hope for you and my happiness that you will be women leaders and some men leaders is that we all adopt a honest and passionate life and build the world we want to live in.
Thank you, Leila.
Hi there, I'm Leila Janah. I'm the founder and CEO of a nonprofit organization called Tzemach. We connect very low-income people to work over the internet through a model that nearly got me laughed out of the room when I introduced it 6.5 years ago. We divvy up big technology projects from companies like Microsoft and Google into very small tasks, and then we teach extremely low-income women and youth how to do those tasks, and that model has lifted about 27,000 people out of poverty since we started. So, thank you. I wanted to share three pieces of advice from a very rocky road. The first comes from my Belgian grandmother, whose name is Christiane, was Christiane. She hitchhiked around the world after World War II, starting with just $5 overland from Europe all the way to India and eventually to the US. And when my parents were buying their first house in the US as new immigrants and they were extremely afraid of signing this mortgage, she looked at them and she said, "The world is a vast and wondrous place. The world is beautiful. Trust the world." That's been amazing advice throughout the founding of Tzemach. The second piece of advice is to question everything all the way back to the first principles. So often we think that things are the way they are because of intelligent design, because somebody super smart or some group of academics came up with the best system ever to do X, Y, Z. Actually, things are often the way they are because of an accident of history. And so it is our duty to challenge things and to make them better than they were in our parents' generation. My last piece of advice is to remember that in our quest to conquer the world, that human beings are a combination of selflessness and self-interestedness. And so often, or self-interest, so often we leave the selflessness side of ourselves for nights and weekends for our charity work. It is our duty to inject that into our day-to-day business, into the work that we do to improve corporations, to improve civil society, and to improve government. So that's my last piece of advice, to remember that selflessness should be embedded in everything that we do. Thank you.
Thank you, Leila.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Blumenstein. I'm the Deputy Editor-in-Chief of the Wall Street Journal, and I want to tell a bit of a personal story. One of the biggest risks I ever took was moving to China with three young children, age 2, 5, and 7. I believe my youngest daughter may be here tonight. She's now 11. This was a bit of a crazy thing. I had been very fortunate at the Journal. I was promoted every single time I had been on maternity leave, but this was downright. And I was talking about this with my new friend from Nike today, that there are companies that actually do this. But this was downright nutty to go to China. And I have to say, the thing that I was most worried about amid this move, and no, I was not fluent in Mandarin, I was not a China expert, was that my oldest child was a picky dresser. And he was going to British school, and he was going to have to wear a best dress with a jacket, a tie, and a button-down shirt. And of all of the things, and my husband Alan may be here as well, that we were worried about, I was really uptight about this. And after a week of being in China, when Jacob got on his new bike with his best-dressed uniform and his tie and his button-down shirt, and he rode away, I had tears in my eyes, and I realized that everything was going to be just fine. My bureau won a Pulitzer Prize the following year, and taking that risk to go to China was the best thing that I ever did. I feel that women these days too often hear that they can't do it, that they can't be a working mom, that they can't be a supportive wife, that they can't be a friend, that they can't be a sister. And I have to say that there is this wonderful, messy middle with rough edges and the right partner that really works for so many women. And I think we have to be better at talking about this and embracing it and really inspiring the next generation, because all of us up here have that duty now to encourage other younger women to do exactly what we're doing. Thank you.
I'm not tall enough. Hello, my name is Sukhua Mu. I'm from Cambodia. When I was 18 years old, my parents put me on a plane for Paris, for France. That was not my choice. A year later, 1973, I made my choice. I came to America. And that choice made me the woman I am today. I lead by challenging leaders to look at the truth, to tell the truth, and to serve the truth. I say to my prime minister, who has been prime minister for over 30 years, I say the truth is that the women who sell their bodies is not their choice. Let them have their own choice. I lead by challenging leaders to speak the truth, listen to the truth. And every day, as a member of parliament, I go on radio and I tell the truth about the workers who need not to make $1 or $2 a day, but they need to make a living and life and live a life with dignity. I challenge leaders. That's how I see leadership. I also challenge myself. I challenge myself three times. First, in 2009, I challenged myself by suing the Prime Minister of Cambodia. I got myself into trouble. He sued me back. But I took, for 2 years, I went all the way from lower court to Supreme Court. I put this judiciary of Cambodia into action. I sued the judiciary of Cambodia. That is how I lead. In 2013, just recently, sorry, 2014, no, 2013, my party, the opposition party, won the election, but it was stolen from us. 2014, I went to Freedom Park that was totally barbed wired by the army. I went there and I stood there. I went every day for almost 3 months, got myself into trouble again, got into jail. Got out of jail, and now this is a challenge, and I need you to help me. I am pulling together a program called Thousands of Lights for Women. We are going to Cambodia. We are going to train 250 women from the opposition to run for elections at the lower level and to win this election. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
So my mother used to tell me when I was growing up that people who are afraid of the future simply refuse to see it. Now, last week would have been her 80th birthday if I wouldn't have lost her suddenly 10 years ago. And she was the best leadership role model that I had. And there's something special about her. She was born in the segregated South. And she endured so many hardships, so many obstacles in life. And when I became about middle school age and I started to endure just a smidgen of some of the same challenges that she'd endured for years, she looked at me and she said, "Latondra Kay, you can either walk around with your bottom lip hanging or you can do something about it." And so I really devoted the rest of my life to trying to do something about it, to really lead by the example that she set for me. I really wanted to help people confront the issues that I think really keeps us separated, that keeps us apart, that really slows the progress from reaching a fair and just society that we all really want. The truth is that we are all very different from each other. And unless we really talk about those differences, we really, really can't use them for good. Now, I used to think a key part of my job at Toyota was getting people out of their comfort zones so that we can have those difficult conversations and solve problems together. And then I realized this is not the right way to think about things because no one wants to be outside of their comfort zone for very long. Everyone wants to go right back in it as soon as they possibly can. So I don't think people really, really are wired to want to talk about difficult things like gender equity, race relations, sexual orientation. And when that happens, it leaves a lot of room for misunderstanding and prejudice. So I've come to think of my role differently as I lead social innovation for Toyota today. And really, it's about expanding people's comfort zones, helping them to acknowledge the future, and then stretch to meet it. Now, I've learned one practical way to help people do this. And that is, I've stopped asking so much why, but started asking the question, how? Because the way I see it is, why is talking about the past or even today, but how is talking about the future? And the world is changing so quickly. Among other things, it's becoming more demographically diverse, with more opportunities for women. Look at these wonderful women surrounding me. You know, that's very exciting. It's very energizing. But as my mother warned, it can also be really harrowing to people who really can't see what's coming. So I think the challenge for all of us as leaders, if we really want to be effective, is to really paint a clear picture of the future and then empower people to figure out how to get there. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Gayle Tzemach, and I'm an author and a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. And I consider myself incredibly lucky because I never had to look farther than my own family for my role models. Those of you from D.C., my mom was a single mom. We grew up in Greenbelt, Maryland, in PG County. Yes, some people come from there. And what was really fascinating was whenever I would feel sorry for myself as a kid, my mother, who worked at the phone company during the day and sold Tupperware at night, would look at me and say, "On a scale of major world tragedies, yours is not a 3. which is actually not very funny when you're seven. But later in life, you really think about it, and it's 100% true. My aunt is from Ciudad Juarez, Mexico. She was a survivor of domestic violence from the time that she got married at 15 until she finally had the courage to leave when she was well into her late 20s and left with really the shirt on her back and the children that she had. And when I called her and said, look, I'm thinking about applying to business school. I don't know anybody who did it. I was the first person in my family to graduate, immediate family to graduate from college. And certainly didn't know people who had gone to graduate school. And I said, you know, look, business school, this crazy idea, I'm never going to get in. I'm going to have to spend like 20 years preparing. And my aunt said, never import other people's limitations. And it was the best piece of advice because so many times women somehow think that you have to look to other people for a roadmap. The roadmap is yours. Do not look for those steps that people have already taken. Go make them yourself. And then if somebody else needs them, you've left them a path. But so many times people say, well, how can you're talking about, and all women talk about is what we can't do. But it's so silly, because why don't we just talk about what you can, which is anything you put your heart and your mind and your guts to. Because the last thing I want to talk about is what I learned from an incredible group of women. I just finished a book called Ashley's War, about one of the first teams of women to go alongside Special Operations on night raids starting in 2011 while the combat ban was very much in place. And they taught me something which I will always remember, which is to embrace the and. That you can be fierce and you can be feminine. You can be fit and you can be caring. You can be incredibly intense and you can also be nurturing. You can love cross-stitch and really be into CrossFit. Right? Women live in the and every single day, and somehow we still are shocked when we see it. We don't live one-dimensional lives. And so it's about time for women to take responsibility for the fact that you can be and do what you want. You just have to do the work and leave the path for others to follow. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gayle. Jacqueline.
Hard act to follow. Embrace the and it's a real honor to be here among all the women on the stage. My name is Jacqueline Novogratz. I'm the founder and CEO of Acumen, which is focused on changing the way the world tackles poverty, and I'm also a very proud trustee of the Aspen Institute. I'm in a resettlement area about 2 hours outside of Delhi, India. It's a wintry day, and winter days in Delhi can be extremely cold, and I'm dressed for summer. And I'm visiting an informal house, sitting in a tiny living room with pink walls, meeting a tiny but fierce woman named Dampati. She's a borrower from the Self-Employed Women's Association's new for-profit financing company for women just like her who are rebuilding but don't have any legal title and are trying to borrow against it. And she's telling me this extraordinary story of her life about how she had to watch her home of 15 years get demolished by bulldozers in a slum clearance in Delhi, and how she and her 10 family members then lived in a tent for 7 years before they could raise enough money from moneylenders and build this ramshackle little house. And I was listening to her story as she was telling it, and I was freezing and shivering, and she noticed, and she sent her sister across the street to make me a cup of tea because her house had no heat, no water, no toilet. And the sister came back, and it was this tiny cup, and she offered it to me, and I greedily gulped it and loved the feeling of the heat and the sweet and the milk. And when I finished, she offered another, and I leaned forward to take the other. And thankfully, I stopped because I noticed her family around her waiting for me to be sated until they would serve themselves. And in that moment, I realized that in her ability to give more than she had, I was finally humbled to take less than I desired. And I stopped and I asked myself, have I lost some of the grace that she is showing? And I have to admit that as my life has gotten more distracted and mad-paced, that I think that I have. And the leadership lesson for me that moment is that if every day we could take a moment to experience awe, to choose awe, then we'd need to find a bit of a slowing down, a sort of presence the taking the time to look at another person, to see the beauty in the ordinary, and that when we do that, and it sometimes takes courage, particularly when we look into the faces of people the world would rather not see, we might find a connection to our own human part of ourselves that really wants to shine. And so this was my gift from Dampati, to remember in that moment that we will not have dignity as a human race until every one of us has dignity. And sometimes that dignity can exist in a little tiny cup of tea. Thank you. Hi, Jenna.
Love more, not less. That's the lesson I've learned again and again. I first met Lily when I was 23. She came to the US from Jamaica at the age of 15 to work as a nanny for a family who promised her a US high school education and a salary that would be sent home weekly to support her family in Jamaica. She lived and worked with that family for 15 years, helping them raise three children. Her employers, however, cut off all communication to the outside world, never allowed her to attend school, never sent her salary home to her family, and restricted her every move. At the age of 30, she finally escaped, found my organization, and I helped her seek justice. In talking with her about her options, she made it clear that whatever happened, she did not want to press criminal charges, because she did not want the children that she loved and cared for to grow up without their parents. Despite everything that she went through, she was compassionate and generous. I think of her often, particularly in times of anger, especially in moments when I feel under siege. The hardest moments for me as a leader have been moments when I've taken a leadership risk and felt vulnerable or exposed, criticized or judged. In those moments, it's easy to harden, to put up a defensive armor, or to dehumanize the people who've criticized you. And in those moments, I connect to the power of Lily's generosity and the way that she got bigger and chose to love more, not less. And that would be my advice. Love more, not less, especially when you're inclined otherwise.
My name is Hannah Jones. I am the Chief Sustainability Officer for Nike, and I run an innovation accelerator, which basically means I try to support all the disruptors in the world to do things a bit differently. I am a single mom. I have two children, and my daughter has type 1 diabetes. I'm an executive in a major company, and sometimes life can look like it's going very fast. So one of the things I try to practice is presence. I don't do very well. But I try to think of four things when I get up in the morning to guide me in how I think about my day. And the first one is really about living with purpose. I came to Nike because I wanted to make a difference around workers' rights. I wanted the women in our supply chain to have access to their rights and to be empowered. And now I'm at Nike because I want to showcase that business can thrive in a low-carbon economy and that we can change the world and continue to enable the economies to grow at the same time, which has always been presented as a zero-sum game and impossible. I like impossible. Every day I ask myself, am I doing the right work? Am I meeting that purpose? Am I leaving a legacy, whether it be around the people that I support or the work that I'm doing? Because if I'm not, what the hell am I doing? My second mantra that I repeat to myself, and this is a harder one, is about being fearless. Because disrupting the status quo is not always welcome. The status quo doesn't like being disrupted. And so you have to be fearless, but to be fearless, you have to let go of caring about the consequences. And to me, that sums up, that's really about letting go of ego. It's about saying, I am going to do this, even if it means that my status, my security, how my ego sees myself in the world, none of that actually matters. What matters is disruption for that purpose. And sometimes it's difficult, and when I feel myself in that place of fear, I have to ask myself whether I'm getting a little bit too comfortable and making it a little bit too safe, because innovation and comfort don't go together. My third is counterintuitive, and I'm running out of time, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. Give power away. Most people have told me that climbing a career ladder is about amassing power and territory, and it seems that that's how we reward people. But what I have learned is that when I give power away, I'm giving that idea or that innovation to someone else to care for. And that's how my ideas have become more powerful, and that's how I've seen innovation go to scale. And finally, pursue balance with ruthless determination. I try to model the behavior that the young women that I mentor and work for me will realize, so that they will realize that they can have a career and they can have children, and that it isn't also a zero-sum game. A young woman in my team came up to me and said, Hannah, I aspire to be you, but then I know I could never have children. I said, have you met my kids? Take Fridays off. Go on holidays. Take all your holidays. Cook dinner for your kids. You're going to be a better leader for it. And you will empower all those other women in the world to realize that this is the way that we can lead and make a change. Thank you.
Raney, thank you.
Hi, I'm Raney Aronson. I am the executive producer of Frontline, and I'm standing like this. I love it. Thank you. So, right, I'm going to talk about bravery. So it's pretty brave to take over Frontline from the founder, David Fanning, after 33 years, right? I could talk about professional bravery, but actually what I want to talk about is emotional bravery. And one thing, I was so glad you almost just teed me up, thank you, that I wanted to talk about is the question that I get constantly from younger women. How do you do it? How do you do it? How do you have a big job? How do you have children? I have a 6 and 9-year-old. And how do you actually do it? And when I was a younger mother, my kids were younger, I would just smile and almost demur. I didn't know how to answer it because it was so messy to do what I was doing. Really, right? Anyone who's a mother, any working mother knows the truth of what it's like. But what I realized a year ago, and this is just by pure chance, was I met Ai-Jin Poo. And she's right there, and it's kind of remarkable that she's here tonight, because we started a conversation that actually changed my life, which is I started to tell her about my nanny. My nanny is the most remarkable partner to me, and you're there fighting for the rights of my nanny and so many other incredible domestic workers. And I realized, as I told her this story about how I actually do it, right? I have a great partner, but I have a phenomenal nanny, that I had to say those words. And as a woman, it was complicated for me to talk about another woman who is taking care of my children with me. And I'll just share one story with you, because I think it's so important that we talk honestly about how we do juggle and we allow for a conversation about the reality. So the story goes like this. My son's a year old and he's so cute, and I have to work so hard. And you can imagine, to become the executive producer of Frontline, I have worked hard. So my nanny is holding my son and she says to me, look at him looking at me. He loves me. And I had this complete shock. My son loves my nanny, right? But then I realized, of course, she is a person too. And she's trying to show me that she is important and that she's successful in her job. And the way that she showed me this is by saying those simple words, that your son loves me, and that's okay. And I would just say to all of you who are in leadership positions, who do have these important people in your lives, talk about them and include them in the story about how we're doing this. And you'll feel better, I feel a lot better. And they certainly will feel incredibly valued. And you'll give younger women hope that they can do this. This is okay, it's messy, but you can do it. Thank you.
And Bina.
All right. Hello, I'm Bina Venkatraman. I'm a writer. I am the former senior advisor for climate change innovation in the Obama White House, and I teach at MIT. So I recently got an heirloom from my great-grandfather, and it got me thinking about my views on leadership. My great-grandfather was a strong-willed, sharp-tongued music and art critic in India, and the only person more sharp-tongued, strong-willed, and feared than my great-grandfather, from all accounts, was my great-grandmother, his wife. And she, in the 30s and 40s, built a cosmetics empire. Kesavardhani grows hair. That's the slogan. And she was also the first woman in her city in India to drive a car. And there's still news accounts that attribute that to her. So I have this heirloom. It's a rare Indian instrument called a dilruba with many strings. It sounds like a cello, a melancholy cello, wandering through the Himalayan fog. And when I hold it in my hands, I feel chills. Not just because of the sounds that it makes, but because I feel the presence of my ancestors, and I feel the foresight that they had. And what this got me thinking about was why we leave so many heirlooms within our families, but so few heirlooms within our societies. We live in an era of short-term thinking. Companies report quarterly profits. Students and teachers are evaluated on annual test scores. We look at agricultural crops based on their annual yields. We're learning so much in this era of technology and science and progress. We have greater predictive power than we've ever had about the future, which is really exciting. We actually can model, more or less, how sea level rise will look in the city of Miami 30 to 50 years from now. That's a lot of vision. It's a big telescope looking into the future. But with this, I think, also comes an obligation to think more about future generations and the heirlooms that we're leaving behind as a society. So what does it mean to leave an heirloom? It means, I think, one, to think about how what we invest in research and development today will become the cures for cancer tomorrow or the exploration of the cosmos for tomorrow, about how we can conserve and use resources better, leaving fossil fuels in the ground, so that future generations will be able to have a relationship to the planet that's a healthy one and like what many of us have experienced in our own youths. Finally, I think it's about passing the torch, making sure that every child can learn and read and eat so that they have the ability to solve problems the way that we have the ability to solve problems today. So when I think about leadership, I think it's about resisting the impulse to only drive results in the short term. That's an impulse that we all have, and it's an important one. But also embracing the intuition that what really matters are the results that we drive for the future.
Thank you all. Thank you all, and thank all of you. The truth is, Kitty knows that we were worried that we wouldn't have enough time, and I wish we had a lot more. And maybe we'll get that opportunity next year. Very seriously, I just want to say that as I'm listening, I'm thinking, look at these women. Everybody looks different. Everybody comes from a different place. Everybody's doing a different thing. And they're leading maybe differently. But what am I hearing that's common thread throughout? And I think
there's a clear thinking in every one of these women about what motivates them and what is their purpose, not just for themselves, but for their children and other people's children and for the future. And I find that very compelling and motivating. And I also want to say that everybody, we've talked about being fearless, and I think all of the women up here are fearless, and I think they've all been afraid. And I also want to say that it is an amazing group of aggressively balanced and generous women. So thank you for modeling for me, for my two teenage daughters in the audience, and for all of us here. We're going to get a chance to ask them all questions, but we're going to do that in a more relaxed one-to-one atmosphere. We're going to go outside there in the back. And I know that, Kitty, I think you wanted a picture for posterity. So I don't know if there's somebody out there, but please join me in thanking these amazing women who lead. We can all stand up.